We are less bored than our ancestors were. But we are more afraid of boredom. We have come to know, or rather to believe, that boredom is not part of the natural lot of man, but can be avoided by a sufficiently vigorous pursuit of excitement. As we rise in the social scale, the pursuit of excitement becomes more and more intense. Those who can afford it are perpetually moving from place to place, carrying with them as they go gaiety, dancing, and drinking. But for some reason, they are always expecting to enjoy these more in a new place. Those who have to earn a living get their share of boredom, of necessity, in working hours. But those who have enough money to be freed from the need of work have as their ideal a life completely freed from boredom. It is a noble ideal, and far be it from me to decry it. But I am afraid that, like other ideals, it is more difficult to achieve than the idealists suppose. After all, the mornings are boring in proportion as the previous evenings were amusing. There will be middle age, possibly even old age. At 20, humans think that life will be over at 30. Perhaps it is as unwise to spend one's vital capital as one's financial capital. Perhaps some element of boredom is a necessary ingredient in life. I wish to escape from boredom is natural. Indeed, all races of mankind have displayed it as opportunity occur. Wars, pogroms, and persecutions have all been part of the flight from boredom. Even quarrels with neighbors have been found to be better than nothing. Boredom is therefore a vital problem for the moralist, since at least half the sins of mankind are caused by the fear of it. I do not mean that monotony has any merits of its own. I mean only that certain good things are not possible except where there is a certain degree of monotony. A generation that cannot endure boredom will be a generation of little humans, of humans unduly divorced from the slow processes of nature, of humans in whom every vital impulse slowly withers, as though they were cut flowers in a vase. What applies to drugs applies also, within limits, to every kind of excitement. A life too full of excitement is an exhausting life, in which continually stronger stimuli are needed to give the thrill that has come to be thought an essential part of pleasure. A person accustomed to too much excitement is like a person with a morbid craving for pepper, who comes last to be unable even to taste a quantity of pepper which would cause anyone else to choke. There is an element of boredom which is inseparable from the avoidance of too much excitement. And too much excitement not only undermines health, but dulls the palate for every kind of pleasure, substituting titillations for profound organic satisfactions, cleverness for wisdom, and jagged surprises for beauty. A certain power of enduring boredom is therefore essential to a happy life, and is one of the things that ought to be shared with humans. The special kind of boredom from which modern urban populations suffer is intimately bound up with their separation from the life of Earth. It makes life hot and dusty and thirsty, like a pilgrimage in the desert. Among those who are rich enough to choose their way of life, the particular brand of unendurable boredom from which they suffer is due, paradoxical as this may seem, to their fear of boredom. in flying from the fructify kind of boredom. They fall a prey to the other far worse kind. A happy life must be to a great extent a quiet life. For it is only in an atmosphere of quiet that true joy can live. All great books contain boring portions. And all great lives have contained uninteresting stretches. Imagine a modern American publisher confronted with the Old Testament as a new manuscript submitted to him for the first time. It is not difficult to think what his comments would be. For example, on the genealogies. "My dear sir," he would say, "this chapter lacks spec. You can't expect your reader to be interested in a mere string of proper names of persons about whom you tell him so little. You have begun your story, I will admit, in fine style. And at first I was very favorably impressed. But you have altogether too much wish to tell it all. Pick out the highlights. Take out the superfluous matter. And bring me back your manuscript when you have reduced it to a reasonable length." So the modern publisher would speak, knowing the modern reader's fear of boredom. He would say the same sort of thing about the Confucian classics, the Quran, Marx's Capital, and all the other sacred books, which have proved to be bestsellers.